Hey everyone, and welcome back. Today we're diving into something that's been making waves lately, AI and what it means for creatives.
It's everywhere these days, right?
Seriously. It's like every time I turn around, there's a new article or headline about how AI is gonna like revolutionize music or art or writing.
You've nearly got everyone talking.
For sure. So we're gonna try and make sense of it all today. We're looking at this article from a website called uber.la. They focus on AI and digital marketing. Have you heard of it?
Oh yeah, I've come across it. They have some pretty insightful stuff.
Totally. So the article we're looking at is called The AI Creative War Starts Now. An AI Antagonist Speaks Up. It was published on April 8th of this year.
Catchy title.
Right? And the author is John McElhenney. And what's interesting is that he's actually used AI a lot in his own work, like extensively.
Oh really?
Yeah. But now he's kind of raising the alarm about its potential downsides.
I can see that being a bit of a paradox, someone so familiar with the technology also being wary of it.
It is. It's not like he's coming from a place of ignorance, you know?
Yeah.
He actually says that AI tools like ChatGPT helped him build this massive website.
How massive are we talking?
Over 2,000 pages. And he did it in under 6 months.
Wow. That's impressive.
I know, right? It's mind-blowing how fast these tools can work.
It makes you think, though, if you're a writer or a musician or an artist, are you suddenly competing with a super speedy robot?
Exactly. That's what McElhenney's getting at. He even uses the example of what happened in India. They had this huge phone support economy.
Right. I've read about that.
But AI-powered customer service could potentially wipe that out.
And that's just one example of the economic disruption we could be looking at.
It's not just about jobs disappearing, though, right?
No, it's about the very nature of creative work changing. Like, what does it even mean to be a creative in a world where AI can generate content so easily?
That's a big question, right? So how does AI actually change the creative process? Like, what does that look like in practice?
Well, McElhenney talks about how using these tools made him realize that AI excels at generating quantity. Imagine you need a blog post or a song or a logo.
Doom. Done.
Exactly. AI can spit it out in seconds, but the question is, does speed always equal quality? What about those human touches, the nuances that make art truly resonate with us?
That's a good point. It's like, are we sacrificing depth and meaning for speed and efficiency?
And that's something that McElhenney really grapples with. He argues that AI-generated art can often feel like clip art.
Clip art, like those cheesy graphics from the 90s.
Exactly. Technically proficient, but kind of soulless. He compares the current state of AI to the rise of clip art, which, as we know, didn't kill graphic design, but it did change the landscape.
So he's not saying AI will destroy creativity, but it could maybe flatten it somehow.
I think that's a good way to put it. There's a risk of homogenization. What if everything starts to look and sound the same because it's all coming from the same algorithmic well?
That's kind of scary, actually.
It is. And that's where his concept of an AI creative war comes in. He's basically calling for creatives to be more intentional, more discerning about how they use AI, and to really fight to preserve those uniquely human elements of art.
It's a pretty dramatic term, AI creative war. Do you think it's really a war?
Maybe not literally, but it's definitely a wake-up call. Like, we need to be having these conversations now before it's too late.
Absolutely. So, to kind of highlight his point, McElhenney did something pretty provocative. He created this project called taylorsversion.ai. Have you heard about this?
Oh yeah, I read about that. That was all over the internet.
It was. So basically, he used AI to generate an entire album of demo songs in the style of Taylor Swift.
For a fictional upcoming album called The Tortured Poets Department, which is kind of a brilliant title if you think about it.
It is, but here's where it gets really interesting. He's actually planning on submitting these AI-generated songs to platforms like Spotify and YouTube.
Wait, really?
Yeah, just to see what happens, because right now, there are no rules against it.
That's wild. It really highlights the lack of regulation around AI-generated content, like who owns the copyright? How do we attribute authorship? These are all questions we haven't really figured out yet.
Like the Wild West out there.
Totally. Anyone can create anything, and it's getting harder and harder to even tell what's human and what's machine-made.
And what does that mean for artists?
Yeah.
Especially emerging artists who are trying to make a name for themselves.
It's a valid concern. Imagine trying to break through when you're competing with an endless stream of AI-generated content.
So what's the solution? Does McElhenney think we should just ban all AI art?
No, not at all. He's not anti-AI. He actually sees it as a powerful tool. Uh-huh. The key is finding a way for humans and AI to coexist and maybe even collaborate in a way that benefits both.
Okay, I like that idea, collaboration over competition. But how do we actually make that happen?
That's the million-dollar question, right?
For sure. And it's something we're going to keep exploring as we dive deeper into McElhenney's ideas.
Absolutely. Because if we can figure out how to strike that balance, it could lead to some really interesting possibilities, like new forms of art and expression that we can't even imagine yet.
I'm all for that. And I think our listeners are too. So stay tuned, folks, because we're just getting started.
This is going to be good.
All right. So we're back. And we're trying to wrap our heads around this idea of, like, how do we keep the human touch alive in a world where AI is creating so much content?
That's a tough question.
Right. Like, McElhenney keeps talking about this human-generated comeback, but what does that actually mean, you know?
I think it's about reclaiming the value of human creativity in a world that's increasingly dominated by algorithms and automation.
Yeah, like, it can't just be a hashtag or a slogan, right?
Mm-hmm.
We need action. What are some concrete things that artists or even just everyday folks like our listener can do to push back against this tide of AI-generated everything?
Well, I think the first step is awareness, being more conscious of the content we consume. Like, who or what created this? Did a human pour their heart and soul into this, or was it spit out by an algorithm in a matter of seconds?
And then choosing to support human creators with our time, our attention, our dollars.
Exactly. It's like voting with your wallet, but for art.
And speaking of voting, maybe there's a role for policy and regulation here too. Could we have labels for AI-generated content? Or maybe even tax breaks for people who buy art from human artists.
Ooh, that's an interesting idea.
It's worth exploring, because right now there's very little in the way of rules or guidelines for AI-generated stuff. Like, who owns the copyright to an AI-generated song? Who gets the royalties?
It's a legal and ethical gray area, for sure.
And it's only gonna get more complicated as AI gets more sophisticated.
I mean, think about it. If you're a musician and every coffee shop you walk into is playing AI-generated tunes that are, like, technically proficient but lacking that spark. Yeah, it's kind of dystopian, isn't it? Like, a world where all the music sounds the same because it's all coming from the same algorithm.
And McElhenney actually said that he disliked the AI-generated Taylor Swift songs that he created. Which honestly makes me even more curious to hear them.
I know, right? But I get his point. It's one thing to marvel at the technology, but do we really want to live in a world where algorithms dictate our artistic tastes?
No way.
And that brings us back to the question of value. If AI can churn out decent music art writing, what does that say about what we truly value in human creativity?
That's a deep question.
Yeah.
I think it forces us to look beyond just the technical aspects of art. Like, yeah, maybe an AI can write a catchy melody or paint a pretty picture, but can it capture the raw emotion, the vulnerability, the lived experience that goes into truly great art?
I don't think so, at least not yet. And maybe that's what we need to focus on, like the things that make human art unique and irreplaceable.
I like that, emphasizing the things that AI can't replicate. Because it's not like AI is going away anytime soon, right?
No, it's here to stay.
So we need to figure out how to coexist with it. And McElhenney actually talks about this. He says that he continues to use AI in his own work, but he's very deliberate about it. Like, he sees AI as a tool, not a replacement, kind of like a collaborator.
Yeah, he focuses on the areas where he believes humans AI. He uses AI to streamline certain tasks, but he never lets it dictate his creative vision.
So it's about finding that balance, right? Like, AI can handle the grunt work, the technical stuff, but the human artist is still the one calling the shots, the one infusing the work with meaning and emotion.
Exactly. And maybe that's where this creative war can actually lead to something positive. Like, maybe this challenge from AI will force us to be more intentional, more deliberate about what it means to be human and creative.
And to really value and appreciate those uniquely human qualities that AI can't replicate.
I hope so. And that's where education comes in. Like, the more people understand about AI, its capabilities and its limitations, the better equipped we'll be to navigate this new landscape.
Totally. And that's what we're trying to do here today, right? Like, have an open and honest conversation about this complex and rapidly evolving topic.
Because at the end of the day, it's not about humans versus machines. It's about finding a way to work together in a way that benefits everyone.
I love that. Collaboration over competition. So where do we go from here? Like, what are some practical steps that we can take to ensure that human creativity continues to thrive in the age of AI?
That's a great question, and one that we'll continue to explore in our next segment.
So we've talked about, like, the challenges and the potential pitfalls of AI in the creative world.
It's definitely a lot to process.
For sure. But I'm feeling a little more optimistic now, like, hearing you talk about how humans and AI can actually collaborate.
It doesn't have to be an either situation, you know?
Totally. But I'm still wondering, like, what can we actually do to make sure that human creativity doesn't get lost in the shuffle? What can our listeners do?
I think the first thing is to be more aware of where your content is coming from.
Like, is it made by a human or an algorithm?
Exactly. And then make a conscious effort to seek out and support human creators.
Like following them on social media, buying their art, leaving reviews.
All of that. Because at the end of the day, those are the things that actually make a difference.
And speaking of making a difference, maybe we need some bigger picture solutions too, right?
Oh yeah, for sure.
Like, what about regulations or policies that protect human artists? Could we have labels for AI-generated content?
Mm-hmm.
Or even like tax breaks for people who buy art from human artists?
Those are really interesting ideas. I mean, right now it's kind of a free-for-all out there.
The Wild West of AI art.
Exactly. So some kind of structure or guidelines would definitely be helpful.
What about education? Do you think that's important too?
Absolutely. The more people understand about AI, how it works, what it can and can't do, the better equipped they'll be to make informed decisions about its role in our lives and in our creative landscape.
So maybe AI literacy courses in schools or even public awareness campaigns.
I think that would make a huge difference because AI isn't going away anytime soon.
So we might as well learn how to use it responsibly and ethically.
Exactly. It's a powerful tool. And like any tool, it can be used for good or bad.
It all comes down to human choices, right?
That's what it always boils down to.
So I guess the big question is, what does the rise of AI mean for the future of human creativity?
It's a question without an easy answer, and it's something that's going to keep evolving, I think.
But I'm feeling a little more hopeful after our conversation today.
Me too.
It's not all doom and gloom, right? There's a lot of potential for collaboration and innovation.
And maybe even for pushing human creativity to new heights.
I love that idea. Like, maybe this challenge from AI will inspire us to create even more beautiful and meaningful work.
Because at the end of the day, it's the human spirit, the human touch that truly makes art special.
Couldn't have said it better myself. And I think that's a great note to end on. We've covered a lot of ground today, folks, but the conversation is far from over. If AI can create something that sounds like music, looks like art, and reads like a story, what truly defines the value and essence of human creativity in a world increasingly shaped by artificial intelligence? That's something for all of us to think about.
It's a question worth pondering.
Absolutely. So thanks for joining us on this deep dive into the world of AI and creativity. Until next time, stay curious and keep creating.